a couple speakers here this morning from Children's Hospital of Wisconsin. We have Dr. Amy Delaney and we have Megan Van Horn. This was a topic that came as a request from Roy, I think it was, to discuss feeding and nutrition issues in infants. So Dr. Delaney is a speech pathologist and feeding specialist. Amy is a registered dietitian. And so they're gonna share a little bit about themselves and talk with us this morning. Thank you.
Well, thanks for having us. I'm Megan Van Horn. I'm a dietitian at Children's. I primarily work in the GI clinic with their feeding team, but also work in some general areas for outpatient GI. I'm Amy Delaney. I am a speech-language pathologist. I have my PhD from University of Wisconsin with focus on kinesiology and feeding development. So my research is trying to understand normal feeding development, oral motor skills, to create clinical thresholds so we know when to refer kids, when to enroll them in therapy, etc. I work out of the Master's Family Speech and Hearing Center, which is our speech department. Work with Megan in our GI feeding team, which is an interdisciplinary team, as well do clinical feeding, instrumental swallowing assessment, and therapy. The title in here says feeding your baby, but we're actually going to be doing feeding your baby and beyond. So starting at infancy and working our way through. So our objectives for today, to understand the goals and expectations of typical feeding in infants, toddlers, and later years, and recognizing those red flags in their feeding transitions that help determine whether or not a referral is appropriate, and reviewing available resources and when to refer. The feeding stages that we're going to talk about today, we're going to kind of split them up, and we kind of try to mimic well child checks in our timing, and all of these are a little bit in flux. So early feeding start at birth and go to around 6 months of age. We talk about that complementary feeding or transitional feeding period where anything outside of breast milk or formula is introduced. Starting around 6 to 9 months and then hitting some other kind of transitions, 9 to 12 months and then 12 months and beyond. And then you have those school age kids when they've kind of hit their stride. And the guiding principles. So throughout this time, we're looking for structured start and duration meal time. So looking for a good start and end time, looking for appropriate durations of those feeding times, positive experiences, not only at meals, but feedings, even thinking early on. Easy feeding transitions, that's always the goal. Eating in a comfortable and stress-free environment and should be an easy task. And achievement of those feeding milestones along the way. Oh, and I should mention, there may be some slides that have specific branded products on them. We are not promoting those products by any means. They're just examples. So this is a slide that we will round back to, and sorry, it's a little bit small on the projector, but ultimately, this is folders as well. Yes, perfect. So ultimately, we're working our way through this. It gives you kind of what we're looking at for mealtime schedule, portion sizes at those feeding times, and then what skill we're looking for. So Amy put this together in conjunction with myself and another colleague to kind of guide people through this early feeding transition into what we do as adults. How we're setting up these transitions, I'm going to talk about the nutrition part, and then Amy's going to talk about the skills part. So early feedings, what is our goal? Ultimately, we want growth and we want hydration. For breast milk, we're looking at feedings for about every 2 to 3 hours. And those early feedings, we know there's really, it's kind of a mixed bag. So as mom's figuring out breastfeeding, child's figuring out breastfeeding, we know that there's kind of no rule for those first couple of days, weeks. But really once they establish that good feeding, it should be about every 2 to 3 hours. But really that's just a general guideline. We really say feeding on demand, cue-based feeding, especially for those exclusively breastfed infants. formula feeding, typically once they establish that feeding, it's usually more like every 3 to 4 hours, and we have better sense of volumes for these ages, right? We've done research on breast milk feeding, and it's so variable based on mom, based on baby, so we don't really give volume guidance at that point. And we don't necessarily want to give volume guidance because we don't want people weighing kids after every feeding unless there are big concerns to see how much they're taking in. So for formula, we give, they should be able to do 4 ounces in a feeding by about 1 month, and then 6 to 8 ounces per feeding by about 6 months. And those are good guidelines to say that they're meeting their nutrition and hydration needs. As always, we're looking for that cue-based feeding. So even if you have a formula-fed baby and they're showing you signs that they're hungry at 2.5, 2 hours, it's okay to feed them as long as it's not causing any other issues or it's not becoming snacking or grazing. We are always looking for appropriate growth. So you may have a breastfed infant who only feeds every 4 hours, but they're not growing well. Well, then they need to be feeding sooner. And we're looking for appropriate diapers, as all of you are well aware of. Things that I think about when I think about young infants are, what are we missing? So breast milk is always best. That's our gold standard, right? But there are a few things that are missing. So vitamin D supplements should be started in a breastfed infant if they're exclusively or even partially breastfed. The products typically have about 400 IUs in a day. They do get a little bit of vitamin D from breast milk. The 400 IUs covers them entirely for their estimated needs. So they may get a little extra bonus of that. Vitamin D is not one we worry about them getting too much of. And then formula-fed babies, if they're taking less than 32 ounces in a day, typically they still need some vitamin D supplementation. And as you all know, we live further north, so we need extra vitamin D as adults. And the fact that infants are typically covered up pretty well, even in the summertime when they're outside, to protect them from the sun. So they're not getting a lot of vitamin D from UV. The other big one, and this is the one that I did my master's project on, was iron. So iron is not something that transfers through breast milk. Breast milk is very, very low in iron. However, that iron is very highly bioavailable, but breastfed infants still really rely on the iron they get from that, that blood transfer that they get at birth. So really, we're looking at if that lasts them for at least about 4 months is what research has showed us. If they haven't started solid foods by 4 months of age, excuse me, starting them on an iron supplement that's about 1 milligram per kilo per day should give them, help them meet their iron needs. Now there's a lot of controversy with iron supplementation. Let me start there. So you'll see I referenced an article from Pediatrics from 2011 related to this. It's actually a really short but good article that gives a lot of information on that early universal iron supplementation in breastfed infants. Formula-fed infants, we typically don't have to worry about iron, or formula is iron fortified, so we don't worry as much about that. At this point, we'll start talking a little bit more about complementary food introduction in a little bit, and we'll come back to this iron.
Okay, so for these early feedings, we're always thinking about what are they taking, do they have enough iron, what kind of formula, etc. So we're going to shift gears and talk about the skills. So it's great, we can talk about they need 4 ounces at 1 month, 6 to 8 ounces by 6 months, but how are they doing that? And so from a skills standpoint, we are always concerned about safety. That's kind of our easy one, right? Are they aspirating, are they having problems? But I want us to really think about efficiency. So how are they getting that bottle in, or how is that breastfeeding going? How efficient are they? And is that experience for the baby, but also for that mom or the feeder, is it positive and is it pleasurable? It should be. If any of those things are problematic, we're going to see stress during those feeding periods. So when we think about feeding efficiency, we're looking at how much can they take in and how long does it take them. It's kind of the two general categories that we want to think about. We're always asking how much and how often, but we often forget to ask how long does it take your baby to take that volume? Because that really sends a different message about what's going on. If the baby's not growing well, and it seems that they're taking in the expected volume, but it's taking them an hour for a new feeding, that's a problem. versus they're taking it in 20 minutes, expected volume, maybe their energy needs are high, maybe there's some other medical reason why they might not be growing. So this feeding efficiency is one aspect that we can add into any of the questions that we're asking when babies are eating. When we're looking at skills, we're looking at their ability to suck, to swallow, and coordinate that with breathing. Okay, we take this for granted. So at birth, for a term baby, we have well-defined sucks already. We suck, swallow, 1-to-1, okay? 2 to 3 sucks for every swallow is still somewhat typical. Beyond that, we're getting pretty inefficient. My baby has to suck, swallow. They're doing 50% more, if not more, energy expenditure to take in that bottle. It's a very highly complex skill. It takes a lot of coordination. So something like a very mild laryngomalacia could really throw a baby off in their feeding abilities and their efficiency. So some of those very minor things can really throw a problem in feeding when outside of feeding, they seem to be fine. They're not striders, they're not retracting, they're not having any of those problems. Sucking efficiency continues to improve throughout the first 6 months of life, which is what allows them to take increased volumes in the same amount of time for a feeding. So they might go for 15, 20 minutes and get in 2 ounces at birth, and then at 1 month, now they're taking 4 ounces in that same amount of time. They're doing more sucks, they're putting more sucks together, they have fewer pauses between their sucking bursts, they're becoming more efficient. So if those volumes aren't increasing over time, we want to start thinking about, do they have the ability to do that, and what else might be going on? So if you go to Buy Baby and you look at the nipple roulette wall, and even for us as feeding specialists, you don't say, well, what bottle do I use? What pacifier do I use? The shape and material of the nipple really can play a role in how babies do. Now for all of us, we probably had 2 choices that we were offered as infants, and we all seem to do fine. So there's not a magical bottle. However, parents are out there, they're savvy, they're Googling, so if they're coming in, so they're just not doing well, you say, well, what bottle are you using? What kind of nipple are you using? Is it a newborn? Have they gone down to a creamy nipple and the baby's working really hard? Have they gone to a level 3 or a fast flow nipple and the baby's just struggling and choking? Are they on the appropriate type of nipple and that flow rate? If oftentimes you're going to see that baby in clinic, you know, they're ready to eat, you're watching, you can look at what is their nipple or their tongue and lip position on the nipple. What kind of sucks are they using? Do they seem like they're sucking for every swallow? Do they do 2 or 3 sucks, swallow, and then pause, and they have a lot of breathing in between? All of those are good signs that something is going on from a skill standpoint, respiratory standpoint, or beyond. Breathing plays a huge role. So again, any even mild congestion, any mild laryngomalacia can really cause problems with feeding in these first 6 months of life. So from a skill standpoint, red flags that we're looking for. So they're always going to be the same. They're cumulative, right? So any child that's coughing, choking, having breathing changes during a feeding, we want to look at their skill-based issues, any sort of coordination problems. If a parent comes in and says, you know, I've been doing some research and I'm thickening the bottle, or I've had to use a special nipple. They've had to alter the nipple, they've had to go to a preemie nipple, they're going to a fast flow nipple, and the baby's 1 month old. Those are all really significant red flags. And if that's where the family has gotten to get their baby to eat or get the volumes in that are expected, something's going on. If the baby is starting and stopping and falling asleep within 5 or 10 minutes, if they're taking more than 30, and we might say 30 minutes or more, we really want to say 20 minutes or more. We really kind of want to come down. If they're really extending that feeding duration to longer than that time and they're reporting concerns and problems, there probably is something going on. If they're always needing less than that goal volume. So they might have the endurance to do 2 ounces at 4 months of age, and now they're feeding every 2 hours. That might be okay, that might be what that baby can do, but it's still a red flag that we're not taking in the volume that we expect. And again, we're looking at, as Megan will talk about, expected volumes for age. When babies are small, we're gonna have to base that on their weight and their size, so that we're not exceeding their stomach capacity. Anytime a family comes in and they have altered their feeding strategy, it's a concern. If they feel like they have to do something different than pop that bottle in or bring that baby to breast, something is going on. It doesn't mean it's a skill problem. It doesn't mean it's a medical problem. We don't know. But it's a red flag to start asking just a couple more questions about what's expected at that point. Babies falling asleep or really stressed during a feeding again is always a red flag and warrants a little bit more investigation or possibly then a clinical feeding eval, which we'll talk about a little bit later.
And from a nutrition standpoint, really our best indicator is growth. So the things that feed into that, the frequency of feedings. So I'm a newer mom, and if you look at any mom blogs, everybody is all about getting infants to sleep through the night. So in the Failure to Thrive clinic I work in, we're often telling families, your child's not growing, they need to eat during the night. That's totally appropriate for 4 months and under for sure, as you all know. So asking those questions, you know, you may ask frequency and they say, oh, every 2 to 3 hours, but then they let them sleep through the night. That is a concern if they're not growing well. You know, there's a couple lucky people out there who get those babies that do that and grow fine. But most infants still need to feed, especially breastfed infants, at least a couple of times in the night. Volumes that they're taking in. So are they just feeding for a short amount of time, the duration, or the volume of the bottle, like Amy was saying? And always doing that GI screening, as you all do. Are they vomiting up every feeding? Are they stooling out? Are there concerns about the stool consistency that they may be malabsorbing? And really, breast milk or formula only outside of supplements. Supplements meaning vitamin supplements. So I will never forget the family that came in and told me they were giving water bottles, bottles of water in between feedings, because Dad's grandma told them that's how you hold the child off until the next feeding. And we were like, or your child is telling you cues that they need to eat. So that's always a red flag as well. If you hear that anything else is going in, rice cereal in a bottle to thicken it, those types of things as well. And now we're transitioning into complementary feeding, where we start talking about food texture. So this is another handout that we've put together to talk about the type of food texture we're looking at, some examples, and then that oral feeding skill that's necessary. So we're going to elaborate more on this as we go. From a nutrition standpoint, starting right around this time, we're still looking for that growth and hydration. We're also looking for iron fortification. That's for our exclusively breastfed infant population. We're looking for exposure to a variety of nutritious foods. We're not necessarily looking for large volumes at this point, but we want that exposure to variety. And breast milk and formula are still our primary nutrition for those children. This is kind of like the practice or the learning stage. So, as many of you may have noticed in the past, I don't know, it's been like 10 years now, that recommendation of when to introduce foods changed. So we went from that 4 to 6 months to around 6 months. So here's a little bit of the history behind that. The World Health Organization in 2001 came out with a recommendation that in developing countries, it was beneficial for that infant to be exclusively breastfed until 6 months of age. Now there's a lot of things that play into that. It was beneficial from a morbidity mortality standpoint or risk of hospitalization. And we're talking about developing countries. Unfortunately, we didn't have any more research in developed countries. It's come along since then. But the AAP and the CDC in 2008 mirrored those recommendations from the WHO to say, we don't have anything else to say otherwise, so we're going to mirror this recommendation. There's still more research to come. A really good position paper that came out a year ago in the Journal of Pediatric Gastroenterology and Nutrition was an ESPGHAN position paper. So the European Society of Pediatric Gastroenterologists, Hepatologists, and Nutritionists. So not before 6 months for sure. Or I'm sorry, not before 4 months for sure. Anything prior to 4 months increases risks of potentially celiac disease, food allergies, and some other things later in life. And definitely not after 6 months. Then you start seeing feeding skill issues. Now, these are guidelines, remember, so we always have those kids who are going to fall outside of them, but those should be in the minority. For the most part, these are pretty good recommendations to follow. And Amy will talk more to you about the skills of feeding. But from a nutrition standpoint, we're really looking for around 6 months. And when we look at that, that's when we start to worry about what they're getting. So what are we going to give them? Let's focus on variety. However, when we initially start foods, it shouldn't be any more than one new food every 2 to 3 days, and that's to watch for an allergic reaction. Any foods from any food groups in any order, you will, I'm sure you've all heard or been taught different things like do vegetables before fruits, otherwise they'll only eat fruits. And really, they've done studies on a lot of them, and really there's no necessarily best way to do it. So introduce whatever they would like as from a food group standpoint, and not focusing on volume, just really focusing on starting off that feeding transition and having positive feedings. For those breastfed infants, we're really looking for something more specific. We want iron fortified foods. The most commonly used ones are those infant cereals. Now there's a whole gamut of them. Like 10 years ago, it was just rice cereal, right? And now there's multigrain, and there's whole wheat, and there's oatmeal. So remembering that multigrain is going to have several different components in it. So not saying that they can't start that, but there's more than one ingredient in it, right? Where a lot of the other cereals outside of the fortification are just one ingredient. So when we're talking about starting one new food a day, it's one new food that's just a one ingredient. So for those breastfed infants, this is where we're starting to talk about we need to get some iron into them in some way. And then breast milk and formula are still our primary means of nutrition and growth. This is just a learning time. The other thing about iron fortification that I kind of touched on with that last age group is that there are organizations, the iron supplementation is kind of controversial. So some kids in some studies who were started on iron supplementation that weren't iron deficient actually had poor linear growth when they were started on iron supplementation. So there's a lot of controversy in the academic world about whether or not to universally supplement iron in breastfed infants. So some people are saying test and see if you think they need it. Other people are saying, I don't know the exact board, but it's the American Board for OBGYNs is now saying to do delayed cord clamping. So they get a little extra iron at birth that will hopefully hold them through until this 6 month time. So that is more the recommendation at this point. Obviously, I don't know if we have any OBs in here, but I don't have any control over that. So those are some things that they're talking about instead of just universally supplementing iron. So I am not promoting that by any means. But we do worry about iron starting around that 4 months of age. So it's just something to keep in the back of your mind if there are other things that are worrisome or concerning to you.
So they, I'm the OB over here.
Excellent.
So there is a lot more literature on preterm births.
Yes.
In terms of increasing the hemoglobin and hematocrit for the new neonates. The controversy has always been the full term birth and the delayed cord clamping. This has always been the case. The midwifery literature has always pushed that, but the OB literature has controversies. But you're absolutely right. There's more push toward just for a few a minute or so, just delayed clamping, even for a term pregnancy.
That's exactly.
But that is what we need to do.
Yep, that's the exact response I got from my OB when I was pregnant. Preterm, totally. Term, we're not so sure. Thank you.
Okay, so at this point in time, between that 6 and 9 month time frame, so you might see them at their 6 month well child. Of course, you're going to say, have you started spoon feeding or start spoon feeding? And then you kind of don't see them again, right? If there's no problems. And so there's a lot that's happening in this time frame between these visits. So as Megan had said, we're still focused on liquids. They're taking bottle efficiently. We're starting to offer baby foods, and so I'm going to introduce you to the concept of texture and texture transitions more than you ever really care to know about. But it's those fine questions that we'll really dive into. Are they really delaying their advance of diet, not meeting or achieving their milestones? Are they really a picky eater? Babies at this time are not picky eaters. By 9 to 12 months, they're not picky eaters. 12 to 15 months, they're not really picky eaters. They're probably having some problems. And we'll talk a little bit more about picky eaters later. So as they're getting exposure and experience to these new baby foods, they're exploring these. You might have a parent that comes in that wants to do baby-led weaning. So that's an emerging literature as well, and we don't really have an opinion at this point on that. So it's something that you just want to monitor for safety. We want to monitor that they're still getting the exposures that they need, that they're getting some of the supplementation that they actually do need, particularly in those breastfed babies who tend to be the ones that are going to do more baby-led weaning at this point as well. So. And at this point, too, they might introduce the cup. So there's a lot of changes that this child and this family is going through at this point in time. So one example, here's some examples of different types of textures. So we talk about a baby food, and in our minds, we all know it's a smooth food, right? There's not any really major texture to it. It's blended down, regular food, single ingredient foods, etc. So example of a Gerber meal, which actually is more of a texture period, it's that second one in. So when we're starting foods, we're offering something that's very smooth, generally fairly thin, and as we move through that 6 to 9 month time frame, they will be offered more thicker type baby food, smooth puree. We're offering smooth puree because the fatty cheek pads are still there, they're not lateralizing food to the sides, they don't have to have molars or teeth. Lateral dentition for these items, and so they can suckle it in, swallow it down, they don't have to do a lot of manipulation. If families start with something more of a texture puree, you can mash it and you can swallow it, but any of you put that in your mouth, you're actually going to move it over and try chewing it. So when parents are coming and saying, oh, my baby's gagging all the time, well, what are you offering? Is it really thin? Is it too thick? If you start too thick, you don't have the strength and coordination, it's stuck on the mid-tongue. Their brain is saying, this isn't right, they're gagging to get it out, which is an appropriate response. That's not a hypersensitive response, that's a safety mechanism at all of these transitions. So gagging is a concern, but we need to understand why that child is gagging. At what point in that feeding are they gagging? And so they will transition from single ingredient foods to combination foods. And so a lot of the new baby foods are single ingredient, small volumes, because they're not taking a lot of volume. This is practice only. As they move into 7 and 8 months, now the jars and pouches and containers become bigger because they can take more at a meal. They're more efficient with their skill. It also is an opportunity to introduce another type of food into one of their other single ingredient foods that they've had. So there is no infant pureed strawberry, unless you're making it yourself. So you get to your single ingredient first foods, and then you get a combo with apple and strawberry, let's say, or the blueberries. That's their chance to get exposure to another food than what they had originally. So as we start introducing these spoon foods, babies are really inefficient. They don't have no idea. They've never done any of this before. We don't expect them to know what to do. But the literature does say if a child by 6 months of age has daily practice with a spoon food, within 2 weeks they're pretty efficient with that. So if you have a parent calling in within that first month of trying and saying they just are not getting the hang of it, that's a little unusual. But now you have to ask, what is it that you're offering? What texture really is it? How often have you been practicing? And then what is it? Are they just losing interest? Are they gagging? Are they choking? Are they losing it all out of their mouth? They don't have very good tongue control at this point, but they learn that again very quickly. The tongue thrust reflex is still present at this point, but at this time in their age, it's starting to go away, and that's why we can introduce something of this nature. It's presented differently. It's deposited in the oral cavity different than liquid by a breast or bottle. That's deposited further back on that tongue, and it's a different mechanism. So it's a totally different skill set for babies. And then gagging and problems over those first 2 weeks, very common, not overly concerning, but should quickly resolve. And if not,
that's a concern. And we'll talk a little bit more about biting and chewing, but they should be able to do some of those things. So this is actually a 4-month old.
Good, you did swallow right there.
His very first spoon feeding. This is actually one of our feeding psychologists. He's sitting back, you know, he doesn't really quite know when to open. He's opening, closing, doesn't know how to open and stay open for the spoon to go in. Doesn't know how to close his lips on the spoon and keep them closed for that swallow. As she's doing a chin prompt, which we will do therapeutically for kids, we don't necessarily recommend that for 4 to 6 month olds. So we kind of find this as a funny video. But he's interested. She's engaged. He's smiling. He's like, I have no clue. I don't get it. But I'm okay with it. I'm all right. Okay. Within a few months, babies are super efficient. So this is a 7-month old who's had about a month of practice with spoon foods. So now she can lean up. She's able to maintain her mouth opening. The spoon can go in. Her lips come down on that spoon more consistently. Her timing and coordination are just so much better, right? It's just very obvious that she's had some experience. She's not losing it out. And that's how quickly those skills evolve. And so if a parent's coming in and saying, this just isn't going well, it's worth looking at. It's worth asking some questions. It's worth possibly sending them in. So at this time frame as well, parents are offering first finger foods, right? They're these dissolvable, meltable kinds of foods. It could be a graham cracker, a Ritz cracker. There's a lot of different products out there. Gerber has products, Beach Nuts have products. Everybody has different products that they're targeting and marketing for those first chewable foods. So what's difficult at this age is we talk about introducing solids, okay? Is puree really a solid? Well, it's a non-liquid, but it's not a chewable solid, okay? So when we get to something that's in a single form that holds its shape, when it's not confined, it's a solid, it's a chewable solid. And so this is a whole other game that we're dealing with. So Cheerios, kind of dissolvable, not really. Things like Melts and some of those other butter crackers, sure. So these are gonna get brought into the mix as well. And these require a totally different skill set. So now we actually have to have that food go in, that tongue has to be able to do tongue tip lateralization, move that solid over to the side, to the lateral gums. You still don't need to have teeth for these types of foods. You need to be able to control that over there by contracting your cheek and your tongue to hold the food on the lateral gum surfaces while you're opening and closing your jaw. Next time you're eating, pay attention. It's very, very complicated. We take it for granted. How are you not chewing? How's that, you know, you can't wrap your head around that. And again, babies just miraculously learn this, regardless of their parents, regardless of what they're offering. They just kind of figure it out. And again, it should be a fairly easy task. This is a child's very first introduction to a chewable solid. Right? I know I gotta move my jaw, that's awesome, but the tongue isn't quite coordinating with that, he doesn't know how to get that, move it over, it's gonna kind of fall out. The dissolvable solids are intentionally made to be dry, so they're not slipping and sliding, they stay put, to give that child a little bit of time to figure out what the heck to do with it. But again, he's not panicking, he's not gagging. Now he kind of got it in, now he's doing a little munching, right? So he's starting to figure it out. Again, very quickly, sorry, this video is distorted a little bit. Within a month, now this child can get it in, she's popping it over, adding a little babbling, which is nice, I always like to see. But she can actually do a sustained bite. She's moving over, doing some more controlled munching. Again, but this is dissolvable. Now put a diced peach in that mouth, it's slipping and sliding all over the place, right? So it's a very different skill set again. Okay, and then by 8 months, here's our little gal again. Sorry, this is from my dissertation, so I was in people's homes, and they're coming home from work, and I'm feeding their child. Now she's holding it, taking a nice bite, moving it over, much more confined movements, very controlled. Actually moving over for a lateral bite there, controlling in her mouth, much more efficient. So these things happen quickly. So these are the types of things that we want to think about when parents are coming in and they're not doing very well. I'm starting to offer them finger foods. Well, what are you offering, first of all?
You know, are they, can they move it over? Are they munching it? Are they just trying to swallow it whole or mash it with their tongue? Ground peppers don't mash with your tongue until they're sitting in your mouth and really soaked and wet. So, and that can cause problems. So those are things just be thinking about when your kids are coming in. At this point, again, cup, multiple cups. There's not a right or wrong answer. Open cups, straws, sippy cups, valve, no valve, spill proof. There's a thousand combinations of things that people can be doing, but it's a good time, again, to offer different types of cups. So cumulative red flags, coughing, choking, breathing changes, persistent gagging with purees at this time frame would be a concern. Unable to complete by that 9-month time frame, unable to complete containers or full volume of purees, unable to really manage some dissolvable solids. These are things you can work out when they're coming in for that 9-month. If they're straight up refusing smooth baby food, they need to come in. We need to see them.
And nutrition is very similar. It continues to be that growth and the factors that can affect the growth, as well as more so the skills. So poor acceptance of complementary foods. Now we're getting into the 9 to 12 month window, and we're changing those textures of foods. Now, from a nutrition standpoint, we're looking at gradually working towards weaning from dependence on breast milk and or formula. So we're looking for more volume consumption of a variety of those nutritious foods, and making it a stepping stone to weaning eventually by 12-ish months. So this is the time where we're approaching that wean. As the primary source of nutrition, they need to start consuming more nutrients, calories, proteins, vitamins and minerals, fats from foods. And they're kind of working on moving towards more mirroring those family foods, family meal times. Now the textures may not be the same, but the flavors and the schedule can be more similar to a family's eating pattern. And there should now be more volume expectations because we're working towards weaning them off of that primary nutrition source. We still at this point don't want to add extra fats. They don't necessarily need that. Adding salt or sugar to foods to give more flavor, we don't want to do that either. I have had some families come to me and say they're not using the typical spices they would use in their family foods. That, I think, is less concerning. If the family's going to be eating foods that have those flavors in them, it can start to be introduced at this point. It's just the idea that the adult palate's so much different than that infant palate, we don't need to add extra salt and sweet salty. But if there are other flavors that the family is used to, they should start getting exposed to that. So really common question I often get as a dietitian, what volumes are we looking for? And again, this is really a kind of just a guideline. So we're looking for about 2 servings per day from the grains group, 2 to 3 from fruits and vegetables, 2 servings of proteins. And remember, those proteins don't have to be meat. They can be our legumes, our cheese, and our yogurt. We kind of count towards proteins at this point. Because really that dairy group is covered by the breast milk or formula. And you can see the volumes here. A couple tablespoons at a sitting is more appropriate. And this is more so not those infant purees like Amy was talking about earlier. These are more those cut up table foods, that type of thing, which we'll talk about now.
Yeah, so I won't go over what Megan talked about. Tolerating purees, lots of volume, more variety. And at this point now, and likely prior to this time, diced table foods have been introduced. Some soft table foods, those first table foods. We should see some active movement of those solids over, some active chewing. They're still not efficient yet. Chewing skills develop through toddlerhood and beyond from the literature that we have. So they're not adult chewers at 2 or 3. They are still developing. That's why we're not giving raw carrots and other things to kids at that point. As we're moving towards that 12-month well-child visit, we're hoping that children are actually taking a nutritious beverage at their meals by a cup. They're starting to have some exposure to their formula or as they're moving to milk, so they learn that I eat and I drink all my calories and nutrition at a meal. But they have to have the appropriate skills to be able to do that. Bottle feeding at this point is still really appropriate. But what really is developing is that chewing efficiency, just like we looked at sucking efficiency. How much can they take and what kind of time frame? What are those textures? There's very specific guidelines on what chewing looks like, the frequency of jaw movements, the tongue movements, etc. and be able to coordinate all of that as well. And again, we take it for granted. So dentition plays a huge role in how we chew. And we look from the circle of life as we get to our geriatric patients who are losing their teeth and their chewing regresses. So we do need dentition for sensory input and obviously for grinding and shearing and breaking down foods. But for the first foods that we're offering children, they're very soft. Our gums are strong. They can break things down with those without having molars. We have to have jaw muscle and bite force, the food properties as we've talked about. Saliva plays a huge role. So next time you're eating, this is what I want you to think about. Food goes in. Now we actively lateralize that. As we're opening, our tongue and our cheeks come forward to hold the food on our jaws. They retract as we do our closing phase. Kids are biting their cheeks, you're biting your tongue, it's getting in the way, all of those types of things. How much chewing force we need is dependent on textures, etc. Love that video. Okay, so, diced solids again. Now we're talking about small, kind of bite-sized pieces. We're still focused on soft solids. Here's that transition from that baby food option to that diced food option. Again, we're doing cooked versions. We want to set them up for some success. Here's that little gal again. It's one of her first introductions. This is a diced carrot. Remember how efficient she was with that graham cracker? And now look at her kind of random movements. She's not quite as efficient as she was. She's losing saliva because she can't quite control that with her solid. But she's interested, she's engaged, she doesn't look like she's having any major problems. And parents are saying, holy cow, they are gagging, they're not able to break it down, they're swallowing things whole. Those are all very much a concern. So by 12 months, they're pretty efficient at doing some of these soft diced table foods. They're interested in it, they're eating a lot of what the family is eating. You're no longer offering those intended for infant type foods. You can just cut up your own foods. So when they're coming in for their 12 month, they should really be doing a fair amount of three meals, eating family foods, modified, texture modified, bite size modified, absolutely. But if they're not, they're not taking any table foods, they're very limited, or limited variety, that's a concern. At this point, when kids come in for their 12 month and they say they're still on those dry, crunchy dissolvables, it's not a picky eater, it's a delayed advance of diet. We treat that very differently. It's not a sensory issue necessarily. They aren't advancing based on their skills. So it's probably more of a motor skill developmental issue than an aversive reaction to that. So at that point, you can ask again, what are you offering and what shape, what size, et cetera. And if they're doing all the right things and the child hasn't improved, that would be a red flag in consideration for, for taking a look at.
Nutrition red flags at that 9 and 12 month well child exams. Again, growth, poor acceptance of those complementary foods, not necessarily looking at variety so much because they take such limited volumes, but still making sure they're getting variety, but not worrying if they're not getting variety from a plethora of each of the food groups. And then that inadequate volume, so if they're only able to take a bite or two at each meal and not meeting those more tablespoon measurements at meal times. Now we're getting into toddler years, where they're starting to transition into even more adult foods. So at this point, we're going to be looking at growth and hydration again, making sure that we've still got that iron on board for that good brain development, and then consumption of a variety of nutritious foods. Now, not necessarily saying that the child technically weans at this point. Most formula-fed infants will transition to whole milk from a cost standpoint, and that's totally fair, and just making sure that we're not missing any major vitamins or minerals as they make that transition from formula. Breast milk, as many of you know, they can continue to breastfeed as is mutually agreed upon, thank you, by mom and child up to 2 years of age. So weaning or weaned off to whole milk, this is the time where we talk about why whole milk and why not any other type of milk that's on the market these days. So whole milk, good source of fat, good source of protein. And most of those, this is where most of those other alternative milks fall short. Most of them are very low in protein. So if you have patients that are transitioning to rice milks or almond milks, those type of things, if that's what the family, the rest of the family is drinking, it's really concerning. So typically they're low in fat. The fats aren't necessarily getting transitioned to those milks as they're being made into milk, as well as the fact that they're really low in protein. Now, there are children who can't tolerate whole milk for whatever reason. So looking at lactose-free whole milk is one option if it's just the lactose that's causing them issues. Typically, it's not the lactose, so sometimes soy milk is a good alternative because that is a little bit higher in protein than those other nut milks. There are a few other options out on the market now. There's like a pea protein milk that is higher in protein as well. Time will tell how that plays out in toddlers. But really the first one that we would recommend is that whole milk because we get that good source of fat along with that good source of protein. Getting in a variety of food groups and having appropriate mealtime behavior. So this is where you start finding we fall off the wagon a little bit as parents, right? We don't feed them in that structured manner anymore necessarily. You know, that's always gonna happen at times, but we really wanna make sure that we're sitting them down in an appropriate seat, three meals, 2 to 3 snacks a day, and having that specific mealtime setting and not walking around or feeding them on the go as the primary means of feeding them.
Yeah, so during toddlerhood, up to age 2 through 3 to 4, kids are still developing their chewing efficiencies, but we're getting a little bit more liberal with the types of meats that we might be offering them. Again, they're still eating, should be eating family foods, but not those most advanced textures. We really don't want them walking around. It's such a choking hazard. A lot of times parents will come in and say, they just are constantly choking, and as they come in with their meal and you watch them handing food off, the child's climbing on the chair and they're chewing, and we're like, okay, well, what does this look like at home? So sometimes it's just as basic as, please put them in a chair and strap them in. Just because they're out of a height chair doesn't mean they shouldn't necessarily be restrained in a booster chair if they are tending to wanting to get up and leave the table. So as they're coming in for their 18, 24-month checkup, they, again, should be pretty efficient with their chewing. They should be able to feed themselves for the most part. They should be interested and engaged, taking bigger, but they don't need everything in small bite sizes anymore. It should be pretty stress-free. Now, this is a typical time where kids start to food jag and be picky and do all of those things, and it's short periods of time. It's generally transient. If they come back in again a month later and it's not change, it's getting worse, well, then we start thinking about skills. We think about GI. We think about other medical things that are going on that are impacting their desire to eat. And sometimes it's just mealtime structure. And if they're grazing all day long and they're coming to the table and not hungry, of course they're going to act out or not eat what you're offering them. At this point, we really expect most everything from a cup. If they're only exclusively on bottle, that's a concern that they haven't transitioned, unless the parent really doesn't want. I've had some parents that say, I introduced the cup at age 2. Okay. If they're really taking no or very few table foods or really limited volume of table foods, so they should have been able to increase their efficiency again. Really persistent refusals, consistent narrowing of their diet, if they're dropping out food groups we talk about, which Megan will talk about, but if they're starting to drop out texture groups, they used to eat chewable foods and now they're not eating chewable foods anymore. They reverted back to liquids and purees. Those are concerns that they're struggling somewhat. And again, another red flag that we would be concerned about.
From a nutrition standpoint, always growth first. Also looking at those inadequate volumes of the foods or the primary beverage that could be leading to poor growth, and that inadequate variety of foods. So like Amy said, these are the times where toddlers are starting to food jag. They get that picky eater phase. But really we're looking at what is a concerning picky eater versus just a typical picky eater. So dropping whole food groups. So some families will tell you, my kid just ate peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for a week or something like that and nothing else. But looking at dropping whole food groups for an extended amount of time where they just continue to offer, and that's another key too. So making sure that they're continuing to offer all of the food groups as well. The child can be going on a food jag. You can still set the expectation that they're still offered all of the food groups, whether or not they're accepted, and hope. The hope is, and I feel like most of the time, they eventually go back to accepting and getting off of those food chains.
So here's some of our take-home messages. Always looking for appropriate growth and achievement of those feeding milestones. There's an evolving distribution of nutrition and calories and volume. From a nutrition standpoint, we talk about that breast milk or formula, going to complementary foods, and then working towards that age-appropriate diet that they eventually hit. I can just go to sources of iron as well is a big one in children this age. The FIT study showed us that most kids are not getting in enough iron at these ages, at these younger infant toddler stages. So making sure that they have good sources of iron in their diet, because we know that's so important for brain development. And then looking at the structure of mealtimes and positive mealtime experiences.
Yeah, and really starting to add into your practice those texture transitions, because ultimately when parents come in to our clinic or into our exam room, what did they say? They're not eating what they should be eating for their age. They never come in and say, they're not getting enough calcium, right? Like, that's not on their radar. So when parents are coming in, that's what they want. I want to feed my child like their peers are eating, which means it's a moving target, right? Is it cup? Is it milk? Is it table foods? Is it baby food? It depends on that age of that child. So looking at how are they transitioning through all of those different textures, and making sure that it's really a consistent progression. There shouldn't be any major plateaus in that progression. Those first 2 years of life are just, these kids are obviously, you know, just rocking with their development. And any plateaus or glitches that remain consistent are certainly a concern for us.
So we have some resources for you all. CHW.org, there's a search box. You can type in nutrition, and it gets you to a wide array of things, but that first option is going to be something that the dietitians at Children's put together called our Clinical Nutrition Handbook. You'll have access to a lot of evidence-based nutrition information, including some handouts. One that we hand out often is a Feeding Your Baby handout. Another one that's in there that isn't necessarily a parent handout, but definitely a good resource for you, would be General Feeding Guidelines from 0 to 18 years. There's also nutrition counseling available at our New Berlin clinic as well as our Greenfield clinic. And then if there is ever a concern, you know, I talked along the way about those red flags. If there's concerns for growth and you are unsure if it's an organic cause of or etiology behind those growth concerns, always referring to gastroenterology or whoever you might think would be appropriate. Nutrition, we can work on increasing those calories, but if they're not absorbing it or it's all coming back up, we can't work on that. That's not necessarily something we can affect. And then appropriate referrals along the way as well.
Yeah, and so where nutrition and speech really go hand in hand is we have those expectations. We can decide they're not taking in enough. They need more calories, more volume, but we also have identified that they're unable to do that. We need to come up with a plan on how that looks. We need to modify their foods, their bottle, their flow rate, their volumes. We might adjust our typical structure of meal times to smaller, more frequent meals because the baby just doesn't have the endurance or the child doesn't have the endurance to take in those volumes expected for age. So if there seems to be a dual etiology here or concern, then referral to speech for feeding evaluation, wherever that may be. We have our main campus. We also have satellite clinics all over the place where we can also see kids for feeding. Our national organization, the American Speech and Hearing Association, is a good resource too, just for general guidelines for feeding, as well as, which we haven't even talked about, was dysphagia today. So there's some good information there from a provider standpoint, but really for parents too. Another really good organization for parents is called Feeding Matters. So it's a parent-led organization that has really good evidence-based information on their website. So if parents just looking for some other good, reliable information, those are probably two good websites for them to look at.
Another one I have families use is the AAP's healthychildren.org. It has really good parent-oriented information from early on until they're adults. So good information as well, healthychildren.org.
Thank you guys. Questions?
What services are available at the Delafield Clinic? Is it just speech and feeding?
Feeding evaluations, we're not currently doing instrumental swallow. That would have to come closer to my campus or New Berlin, but they can get a feeding evaluation there for sure.
And is this well covered by insurance?
Generally feeding is, so your general speech and language communication is not always covered because they can go to early intervention or versus three.
Mm-hmm.
Feeding is generally not an issue. Because that they just look at that as more of a medical issue.
Mm-hmm.
So we generally don't have problems. If it's state, we have to go through the whole PA process. But evals aren't an issue. So evals, they can come in and that's usually covered.
Can you comment a little more on 9-month introduction of whole milk as an option?
So some of my colleagues in GI doctors would say wait until a little bit later. Other ones say, well, you can start doing small amounts, but definitely not whole milk. I don't think any of my colleagues would recommend whole milk at that point. While whole milk is a good transition at about 12 months of age, that GI tract is just a little immature earlier on to take the differences in whole milk and breast milk or formula. So the protein content is actually a lot higher in whole milk, but the type of protein is the part that's even more different. So the casein to whey ratio is much different. It's actually almost flipped in breast milk formula versus that whole milk. So there are concerns for introducing whole milk as a primary beverage earlier on than 12 months, but I would definitely say some of my colleagues would be okay with like doing yogurt at that age, less concerning. Not eating 4 containers of yogurt in a day, but doing taste, you know, those couple of tablespoons to a couple ounces.
And then the concern is if they are good drinkers and they start taking lots of volume of whole milk and
yeah.
regress in the amount of other foods, now we really are at a nutrition risk.
Yeah.
And that's where we've seen that, where we've had older kids come in on like primary rice milk, and it's just awful because they are not getting any of the nutrition that they need, but they only know how to drink, and that's what they're taking in all day. So it's just a slippery slope sometimes, because parents aren't going to know when to back off on that and hold on to that volume. Yeah.
Could you comment on complementary issues of allergies and versus early introduction, contrasting perhaps gluten versus peanuts?
So like when to introduce things.
Right.
Okay, so a hot topic right now, right, is introducing peanuts early or peanut products early on because studies have shown that it actually helps prevent peanut allergy later. So how many years were we told wait until 2 to introduce all of these things or wait until at least 1 to introduce all of these things? And really now things are starting to come back and say we may have actually, that may not be what we should have done. So the bigger concern from a peanut standpoint is how the parents introduce it. So they say you can start introducing it when you start introducing complementary foods, but peanuts don't necessarily come in an appropriate texture for infants, right? So you, if you want to speak to what you're
sure,
telling families to do for peanuts.
Yeah, obviously they're not chewing it. Peanut butter is super sticky. They're going to gag on it, they're going to choke on it. So we've had parents thin it down a fair amount with their formula because it's really just an exposure
yes.
to it. So
yeah.
it's not any volume. So they will do a modified texture down for something of that nature. But the caveat is if the family has peanut allergy, right, they are avoiding that early introduction.
Exactly.
Yeah.
If there's 3 factors, if there's family history of food allergies, there's 2 others in that study that they just recently published. I've had families add it to the rice cereal,
yep.
same thing,
yeah,
like
it in with something.
Mixing it in to just change the texture to be appropriate. As far as gluten-containing foods, as definitely not introducing before 4 months, that's a big no-no. That's definitely an increase for celiac disease. But after that, I don't think there's any research that I'm aware of that says that you shouldn't be introducing it. And it can be a good source of a lot of B vitamins and other vitamins too. And a lot of those easily dissolvables that they're working on their fine motor pincer grasp with and working on those early chewing, those are going to be gluten containing. So it shouldn't be worrisome to any parents to introduce those things because they contain.
Chubby
yeah.
babies.
And
what was that?
Chubby babies.
Lots of questions.
So it starts off by saying, are we talking like before foods have even been introduced?
Well, I guess there's a continuum.
Yeah. So I would say if no food has been introduced, if they're breastfed, we don't typically put any restrictions on even if they're pretty chubby. Formula-fed babies, we ask some more questions. So how are they mixing the formula? Are they concentrating the calories without even knowing it? You know, it's typically that 2 ounces of water to 1 scoop of powder. Well, are they flipping that or, you know, something in between? Did they add a couple extra scoops because they thought it would help them sleep through the night? Those type of things. So formula-fed babies, we may be a little bit more hesitant on. We would never water down formula. We may just have them, I would say, limit the number of feedings potentially. You know, it depends where this falls in the range. Or possibly limit their volume, but still wanting to meet their hydration needs because that is their primary source. Now later on, once we've introduced foods and foods are in the mix, it's asking what those foods are. So making sure that it's not really fatty foods. You know, I talked about offering family foods, what the family's eating, but I don't want them doing it if the family's stopping in the drive-thru every night. We shouldn't be introducing those foods. Especially at those younger ages. So talking to the family about what types of foods they're giving the kids as well. You know, there's a gamut that I've heard. Some parents say to me, oh, my baby only needs anything except breast milk for the first year, and food's just for the fun of it, right? No, it isn't. It's for oral skill development, and you need to start getting more nutrients right around that 6 months of age. And then you have the other gamut who say they just want to get them all on whole foods. You need to have that balance between the two.
There is, and there's some studies out that if textured foods, so not the baby food, smooth puree, but anything that has some texture that will elicit chewing, if it's not introduced by 10 months, they're pickier eaters, they have a limited variety by 15 months of age, and it's really that, we always talk about sensitive periods in development, so the 6 to 10 months is really a critical time where babies are introduced to all of these things. It's a very natural progression for them. You think about how difficult it is, we just talked about, and maybe just figure it out. And regardless of what kind of parent we are, they just kind of do it, and they're okay. But if we do delay some of that introduction, it does make that harder for them to learn. We end up having to teach them how to do that if they haven't had that exposure or that experience.
The other thing on overweight obesity, if they're drinking tons of milk, that is another big concern. I see a lot of kids who are incredibly malnourished in the sense that they are anemic, not in a good place, but they are overweight, obese. I mean, we don't use those terms before too, but they're really big on the growth chart. Often I feel like they're consuming large volumes of whole milk. So really limiting that. And at those times, there may be an appropriateness. Now, this is obviously case by case, to start watering it down just to decrease their dependence on it if it's really high volumes. You know, I think 16 to 24 ounces by the time they're hitting that 18 to 24 months. And again, you have to make sure that they're getting enough volume and variety of foods to meet their needs. But really making sure, I feel like I've seen a good number of cases where it's almost all whole milk.
And when it's that case, when they're really reliant on a ton of milk, then we start thinking, well, is it because it's just easy and that's what's offered? Is it because they really don't have the skill set for something else? What about the order of presentation at the meal? Are they slapped down a big, huge cup, they slam it, and they're not hungry for something else? So then, from an intervention perspective, we'd say, withhold that milk till later in a meal, get them hungry at the table, eat a little bit more, and then give them that milk. So it kind of depends. That's where you get that red flag of excessive amounts of milk. All right, do they have it all day long? Are they offered it right away at the beginning of the meal? What does that look like? How is that consumed? Are they taking it overnight? So, you know, we get a lot of that too. They wake up and they get big bottles of milk and then they're not hungry during the day.
Please don't give them juice. Yeah, so juice is, if you have a child who's old, you know, after the 6 months, I mean, there's no need to introduce juice unless there's maybe like they're using it a little bit to help with stools. That's not, you know, that's not in my realm, but I see that happening. But not letting them become dependent on juice. That's a huge calorie suck, as well as the fact that they'll fill up on it, they don't eat other foods, and then you just see that growth chart continue to climb.
And there's so many choices now in flavors to add to your water that have no calories and no sugar. If parents really want a flavoring to something, like, my kid doesn't like water, without introducing those extra calories and sugar in between those meals, because that really hampers their hunger at those meals. So that could be a primary reason why they're not coming to the table hungry or not advancing. Okay. I'm running out if you guys have more questions.